and welcome to worship. It's so good to be with you. I pray you well. I'm Rev Malc. I'm the vicar down at St. John's Church in Abbey, Hulton. That's actually where I'm recording from at the moment, in my office next door to the church. I'm part of the team vicar, one of the team vicars in the Bucknall team ministry. And it's really lovely to be with you. It's the 17th Sunday after Trinity. Can you believe that we are in October already? Where has the year gone? Great to be with you. Excuse me. Really looking forward to worshipping with you this morning. And we've got a great service lined up. We're going to pray together. We're going to worship God together. We're going to hear God's word read. And we're going to hear from Andrew, who's going to be preaching, speaking to us this morning. So wonderful. All creation gives you praise. You alone are truly great. You alone are God who reigns for eternity. I'm going to start by praying for us the collect, the special prayer for today. Let me pray this for us. Almighty God, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless till they find their rest in you. Pour your love into our hearts and draw us to yourself, and so bring us at last to your heavenly city, where we shall see you face to face. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen indeed. Well, we're going to worship together now. So, let's praise God together.
You give life, you are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your
like I said at the start of the service, Andrew is going to be preaching for us this morning. First, we're going to hear God's word read for us. And we're going to hear initially from Tina, my wife, actually, who's going to be reading one of the Psalms for today, Psalm 126.
When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, then were we like those who dream. Then was our mouth filled with laughter and our tongue with songs of joy. Then said they among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has indeed done great things for us, and therefore we rejoiced. Restore again our fortunes, O Lord, as the river beds of the desert. Those who sow in tears shall reap with songs of joy. Those who go out weeping, bearing the seed, will come back with shouts of joy, bearing their sheaves with them.
Luke 14, verse 25 to 35. Now large crowds were travelling with him, and he turned and said to them, whoever comes to me and doesn't hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever doesn't carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, doesn't first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he's laid a foundation and it's not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king, going out to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he's able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is neither for the soil nor for the manure heap. They throw it away. Let anyone with ears to hear listen.
Over the world, there are quite a number of buildings which have remained uncompleted for decades, centuries even. At the top of Carlton Hill in Edinburgh, the National Monument of Scotland was planned as a replica of the Parthenon in Athens, a memorial for the Scots who lost their lives in the Napoleonic Wars. But after 7 years, they ran out of money and it's never been completed. Then there's a 49-storey building in Bangkok, which was supposed to be luxury flats. Begun in 1990, work stopped a few years later, and it's been known ever since as Ghost Tower. Or in Bologna's main square, there's Europe's sixth largest church, started in the 14th century. But the intended red and white marble facade only half finished. Then there's a small section of flyover from Cape Town, which dates from the 1970s, part of a planned freeway that was never finished. And finally, of course, is Newcastle's own sad contribution to the set, the Sky Building on the roundabout below St George's. And we can presume that there were similar examples in Jesus' time, which he uses as a very vivid warning, not addressed primarily to potential builders, but rather to the crowds who were following him at this point in his ministry. P.T. Barnum, the great American showman, once observed, "Nothing draws a crowd quite like a crowd." And that's no doubt part of the explanation for the large following Jesus had at the time. But he feels the need to spell out that he isn't just looking for people who will join the crowds listening to him for a day or even a week, but rather for those for whom faith in him will become the most important commitment in their lives. He expresses that quite shockingly by saying, If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Now, elsewhere in the Bible, 1 Timothy chapter 5, we're told, if anyone doesn't provide for his relatives, and especially for members of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. So Jesus' opening words need to be treated with care. At the same time, it's clear, our being a follower of Jesus must take precedence over everything else. Many will say, family comes first. But as the writer of the hymn, Be Thou My Vision, puts it, addressing his words to the Lord, Thou and Thou only, the first in my heart. When deciding what to do, our first consideration must be, what does God think of this? Not what would other people think, nor even what would my family make of it. And we're then told we must hate even our own lives. That's not encouraging self-hatred or discontent with our lot. Rather, it's saying we should obey God's will for our lives, whatever the outcome. Someone once said, if others speak well of us, it doesn't matter much. If they disparage us for our faith, it doesn't matter much. If we have a lot of things, it doesn't matter much. If we have very little, it doesn't matter much. If we're persecuted or lied about, it doesn't matter much. Whether we have a name, a reputation in some circles, or are completely unheard of, it doesn't matter much. For the only thing that really matters is what the Lord thinks of us and whether we've been faithful to him. More than that, we should obey the Lord, even if it risks our lives coming to an abrupt end. The book of Acts records an address by the Apostle Paul to the church elders near Ephesus, which includes an explanation of his own thinking at the time. And now, behold, I'm going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. But I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. St. Andrew's link with Open Doors reminds us that attitude was not just needed among the first Christians. We thank God for believers in many parts of the world today who stand up for their faith, knowing that it may well bring persecution, who care more about the Lord than even their own lives and security. And given how demanding following Jesus might be, he's keen that the crowds following him think carefully about it before making a commitment. As we saw earlier, he does that by alluding to the folly of ending up with a part-finished building because you ran out of money. Verse 28, for which of you desiring to build a tower does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. And Jesus then makes a similar comparison with a king whose country is under attack, who has to soberly reckon up whether he's got the forces to resist or whether he needs to send out his delegates to try and agree some kind of negotiated settlement. Jesus concluding very uncompromisingly, so therefore, any one of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. In the English language, we have a few pairs of proverbs expressing completely opposite sentiments, like too many cooks spoil the broth and many hands make light work. Both give good advice, and the wise person will need to weigh out which of them is more pertinent in any situation. There's a similar pair, he who hesitates is lost, and look before you leap. The previous section of Luke 14 was Jesus telling the parable of the great banquet, which might well be seen in part to be giving a warning. He who hesitates is lost, as he implores people to accept the invitation to God's kingdom. But here Jesus is complementing that by encouraging potential followers to look before you leap. If we don't, the danger is that we won't last very long in his service, and our attempts to be his followers will look as ridiculous as the half-finished buildings I began with. There's a message there in the first place for those who aren't yet Christians, but who see the immense attraction of the Lord Jesus and what it might mean to seek to become his disciple. Jesus is making clear that to follow him will not be all roses. And anyone in that position needs to weigh up carefully whether you're ready to face the demands that being a Christian will make on your life. For it may complicate or even endanger our family relationships, our working life, our security. It's true, Jesus elsewhere promises that in the end we will gain far more than we ever lose in his service. But there will be a cost in some places, and the would-be disciple needs to weigh that up very carefully. There's a message too for Christians as we communicate the Christian faith to others. Are we honest about the demands that it will make on a person's life? The cost as well as the gains that faith brings, both in general and perhaps in saying something about where we felt that in our own lives. Jesus told it straight. So as his representatives in commending the faith to others, as I hope we are, we need a similar honesty. Sometimes we see people who've enthusiastically professed a newfound faith, but who've quickly run out of steam and given up. There can be all sorts of reasons why that happens, but maybe in some instances, it's because those presenting the Christian faith to them weren't honest enough about the reality, the cost of discipleship, as well as its blessings. And of course, for those of us who count ourselves Christians, it also raises the question, have we been carrying on in our faith? Or are there important aspects to our discipleship which, rather than growing, have stuttered to a halt or even gone backwards? In our willingness to share our faith with others, inevitably, if we've been professing Christians for many years, there will be less newness to what we have to say. But are we still as open, as eager in commending our faith to others? What about the priority we give to being in worship and in our own reading the Bible and prayer? Some of those who over the years I've seen come back to faith or return to faith have initially been more regular in church than our regulars. But sadly, there's then sometimes a real fading away. Maybe they've even given up altogether. I suspect it may sometimes be the same story with people's devotional life. Or in our desire to make the most of each day in the service of God and of others, we can so easily go off the boil in our eagerness to do what we can to follow the Lord Jesus, a running out of steam, if you like. If you recognise that's been true of you, of course, the way back to the Lord is always open. When I first preached on this passage about 20 years ago, I remember referring to a very specific building near to where I was then vicar, which was like the ones I began with, where mid-construction work had stopped for many years. But a few years later, when I thought about preaching on the same passage, I couldn't use that same illustration, as thankfully by then the work had restarted and the building been completed. I hope and pray that will be true of the Sky Building in Newcastle. And more than that, I hope and pray that in our lives as believers, where there are areas where we realise we've rather come to a halt in our discipleship, we seek God's grace and forgiveness, and we rediscover the power of his Holy Spirit to get going again in his service. We sing together, "Hear the Call of the Kingdom."
thank you, Andrew, for your word. Wonderful. Of course, we're in that time of year, aren't we? In autumn, I guess we definitely truly are in autumn now. It feels that way anyway. I'm going to put a jumper on and a woolly hat on a regular basis. And of course, it's harvest time, isn't it? I do love harvest. Maybe we'll be having a harvest service soon. But I guess it's a time, isn't it, of Thanksgiving, a time of thanking God for all that he's done for us, all that he's provided for us. I know sometimes when life's hard or we're going through difficult times, maybe we're struggling with health or, I don't know, worries. It's hard, isn't it, to look past them and through them and remember that we have a God who loves us so much. But that's so important, isn't it? It's so important. I think what we're going to do now is we're going to enter a time of prayer, and perhaps let's think about those things. Let's thank God for all that he's done for us, all that he provides for us. But also we'll take some time just to pray. Pray into the situations that are on our hearts, perhaps. And so, should we pray together? Let's pray.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, teach us to offer you our hearts full of thanksgiving and praise. Through all our daily experiences of life, teach us to be joyful always, to pray continually, and to give thanks in all circumstances. Creator God, you made us in your image and provide us with all we need, a world with plenty for all to share and delight in. For this we give you thanks and praise. Saviour God, you came to forgive us our sins and to show us the path we should follow through the highs and lows of all that life throws at us. For this we give you thanks and praise. Father God, we praise you because of who you are, a good and merciful Father who will never leave us or forsake us, ever patient and ever merciful. For this we give you thanks and praise. We pray, Lord, for those who do not have food, water, shelter, the basic necessities of life, for those affected by recent events of fire, flood and natural disasters, for those affected by war and civil unrest, for those who have lost their way, brought down by addiction or health issues, for those suffering because of the political regime in their country, for those struggling with poverty. Father God, you know the needs of all your children and you feel the pain of those who suffer. Bring comfort and relief in practical, mental and spiritual ways as only you are able to do. Stir the hearts and minds of those in positions of power and those who are able to give practical help. Merciful Father, hear our prayer. Father God, we pray for the church, for the bishops and all clergy, for Andrew, our rural dean and vicar here at St Andrew's, for Josh at St Giles, and for Dave and his team at the Bucknall Team Ministry. We pray for all who serve you in whatever capacity, seen or unseen, in our churches, and we pray for all who come into our churches to worship, to meet with you, for those seeking comfort or friendship, for those who know you and those who don't yet know you. May we bring your love to all who turn to the church in good times and bad. Merciful Father, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for the life of our churches, that we listen to your plans and not create our own, that we listen to your words and not words of evil or misunderstanding, that we follow your path and not wander off alone. We pray that you will help us to think about what it means for us personally to welcome the whole community, discover God's love and follow Jesus' teaching. Whatever our circumstances, wherever we are, let our faith be central to our lives. We pray for those who have been baptized, confirmed or married in our churches, for those who have come to events, to renew forget-me-not cafe, afternoon tea, and all those occasions held over the years, for the children who have come through our doors or heard your word in school. We pray for Naomi and her team, giving thanks for Sunday Club, Messy Church and Holiday Club, and praying for the new groups for children and young people, that your word will spread and the groups will grow. Merciful Father, hear our prayer. At St. Andrew's, we pray for the plans for the new hall, that planning permission will be granted and funds will be forthcoming. We pray for the vision of life in the new hall, that you will guide us in using it to encourage and support the community and in sharing your love and word. Merciful Father, hear our prayer. Loving Lord, we pray for those who are ill, in body, mind or spirit. We pray for healing, for compassion and comfort. We pray for carers, for the professionals and for those looking after family and friends, that you will support them and give them the strength and patience to cope with their role. We pray for those who mourn, whether the loss was recent or long ago, who still feel the pain of that loss. We pray for an easing of grief, that by your grace they may face the future content in the knowledge of your love. Amen. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
It's been lovely spending time with you this morning. I hope you've enjoyed the service. Look forward to seeing you again soon in the not too distant future. So take care and God bless. Look after yourselves, all right? Stay warm in this autumn weather that we've got. And I'm going to say a blessing and then I'll send you on your way. So the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be with us all and remain with us always. Amen. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen. God bless and take care. See you soon. Bye.
For your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead.